Coming to you live from the Indianapolis Tower, this is the Splat Zone. Welcome to the Splat Zones. We are a monthly video cast / podcast dedicated to bringing you the best Nintendo-related topics. I'm your host, Nice1983.
And I'm your co-host, Mario After Party.
And guys, it's been a crazy couple weeks here at the Inkopolis Tower. We have recorded 3 episodes in the span of as many weeks, and we are now back to our normal schedule. But that doesn't mean the excitement stops, because today is an extraordinarily special episode of the Splat Zones. It is a 2-segment, extra long episode, and the second segment is a great interview that we were able to obtain. So stay tuned after our closing music to go ahead and you can hear that interview. But not only that, we're adding a new segment to the Splat Zones called the Splat Zones Video Game Reviews, and our first review, Pokken Tournament. As for our topic of the month, guys, we are winding down the Wii U's lifespan as we eagerly await the unveiling of the NX. The Wii U as a system has been considered by many to be a comedy of errors due to the fact that there is no one single thing that can be attributed to the downfall of this console. Some have proclaimed Nintendo hasn't fallen this hard since the Virtual Boy, while a sparse few claim that this is Nintendo's best console since the SNES. The truth lies in the fact the Wii U is not moving the needle, and within 3 short years, Nintendo will announce new hardware for the home console market. Today's episode, Mario After Party and myself will discuss and speculate upon the many issues that have plagued the Wii U since its launch, November 18th, 2012. But before we get into that, let's go ahead and move into our first segment. And that's going to be the Nintendo News Report. We weren't going to do it this month, but some Pokemon Go news came out. And it's some pretty good news. We know what this game's about. We know what's happening. There are some features that they announced for the game. One of them is really interesting to me, and it's creating and attacking gyms. So at some point within the game, you are supposed to choose between 3 teams, and once you're part of the team, you assign one Pokemon to a real-world location in order to defend that location. The idea is that you work with others in your team to set up strong defensive units. This is cool because this is something Mario After Party and myself, we wanted this feature, man. We wanted this feature. We said that we thought it would be cool if we could become gym leaders, and that is exactly what's happening. You can essentially become a gym leader. You set a Pokemon there, and it defends your gym with your team.
Yeah, they didn't explain in depth how that's going to work, but as far as from what we speculated a few months ago, it definitely sounds like you are going to be able to either be a gym leader or be part of a group of gym leaders defending a gym. So that's exciting, and it sounds like that's going to be a lot of fun, although I don't really know how that concept is supposed to work. I still would like to know more on how they're going to implement that, but there's definitely a lot of promising features in the latest news report.
Yeah, man, I'm super stoked about this. Like, it's so cool. I mean, and then, I mean, clearly they talk about evolution in the press release, and it's a different way. It says that you have to catch, you know, a certain amount of the same Pokemon before you can evolve. But they also say that if you explore, you know, your city and you explore your region, that you're actually going to be able to find Pokemon eggs. And then, of course, you have your Pokestops, which are like your, basically, you know, museums, historical markers, and monuments where, you know, you're going to find Pokemon. And it's going to be, this is so cool, like the things that they said about, you know, what this game is going to bring. It confirmed, like, some of our speculation and some of our wants, and I thought that was a really cool way to just go ahead and just do it. I mean, so glad they chose to do it in the way that they did. Do you have anything else to say on the matter, brother?
No.
All right, so let's go ahead and we're going to move into our very first ever Splat Zones video game review. Pokken Tournament. Brilliant, unique, mechanically sound, deeper than you think. I want to start this review by saying I grew up in the era when fighting games dominated the arcades, where two people would square off and relentlessly battle until one remained victor and thus having bragging rights until he heard the words, "I got next," and begin the process all over again. It was an era when a pocket full of quarters meant you wanted to be the very best like no one ever was. Fighting games dominated. Street Fighter, Mortal Kombat, Killer Instinct, even Square got into the mix with Urguys, God Bless the Ring, an arena fighting game that includes characters from Final Fantasy VII. The era of arcades has long since passed in America, yet they still flourish in Asia. But fighting games found a home on consoles, with new iterations of Street Fighter popping up every 2 years or so, and Mortal Kombat and Killer Instinct have been revived as well. Fighting games are here to stay. But new entries into the FGC can be mocked and ostracized. Just ask the Smash community how long it took for even some semblance of recognition from the larger FGC, but that's a different story. All this to say, there's a new game looking to break its way into the FGC, Pokken Tournament. It is a game that strives to not only reach the hardcore and the casuals, it also strives to reach the Pokemon community as a whole. This game wants to serve many masters, but does Bandai Namco's newest fighter achieve that goal? Let's start with the graphics. Pokken Tournament masterfully takes Pokemon and brings them into full 3D in ways that Pokemon Stadium could only have dreamed of. These are some of the best looking graphics to grace the Pokemon franchise. Not only that, they are some of the best looking graphics on the Wii U, period. It is honestly a shame that a game this beautiful comes out right as the console has one foot out the door. The game also features 2D player avatars that are fully customizable that add to the richness of the overall graphics. Pokken Tournament gets a 10 in this category. Moving on to the roster, this is one thing that all fighting games have in common. Character rosters and the richness of said roster can be a thing of anticipation. Just look to the Smash community to see how excited or angry players get when new characters are announced. Pokken Tournament's roster 16 is one area where the game falls extraordinarily short. Bandai co-developed Super Smash Bros. For Wii U with Nintendo, and that game launched with 51 playable characters, 6 of them being Pokemon. There are currently over 700 Pokemon. To limit the roster to 16 seems like a tremendous misstep, and one can only hope this will be rectified by DLC in a similar manner to Super Smash Bros. That being said, the roster is actually pretty diverse, from mainstays like Pikachu and Charizard to the most obscure Chandelure. Each character brings a unique playing style that will have the most competent of the FGC looking to master and develop a metagame, while casual players and Pokemon fans alike will gravitate to the characters they find the most appealing. The roster is slightly bolstered by 30 support Pokemon, which come in pairs and are used to aid the 16 playable characters in combat. Still though, it is sad to see that Greninja, who had received so much hype when he debuted in Smash, is excluded from Pokken in favor of multiple Pikachus. In this category, Pokken Tournament gets a 6. Gameplay. Gameplay is this fantastic blend of 2D fighter and 3D arena fighter. Each battle begins in Field Phase, which is primarily based on 3D fighters like Tekken and Soul Calibur. This phase favors long-range attacks and requires specific directional input in order to fully control the movements of the Pokemon and control the tide of battle. Hitting an opponent hard enough will knock them into Dual Phase, which clearly takes influence from traditional 2D fighters like Street Fighter. It is in this phase that close-range melee attacks can be used to dominate an opponent. Once again, landing a strong enough blow will launch the opponent back into Field Phase, thus adding a new layer of strategy that the most adept players will be able to control almost at will. The game's combat system is both simple and complex at the same time. The game is easy enough for any casual fan to pick up and play right away, yet underneath it all is a complex system that utilizes counterattacks, grabs, strikes, and all can be chained together to perform devastating strings of combos. The game also utilizes a burst mode, which basically performs the same function of a Super in Street Fighter or a Smash Ball in Super Smash Bros. The game also uses the support Pokemon to aid your Pokemon in battle. Support Pokemon can be used to raise HP, perform attacks, and cause status effects, something that can be used to turn the tide of battle. To go back to the combat system for a minute, the main Pokemon series has a rock, paper, scissors approach, with grass beating water, water beating fire, and fire beating grass. Pokken Tournament recreates this in its own unique way, due to the fact that the Firegrass water system was severely hurt of fighting it. Instead, Pokken breaks it down like this: strikes beat grabs, grabs beat counters, counters beat strikes. It is in this way that Pokken Tournament appeals to not only the hardcore, but the casual as well. All this to say, the game is both simple and complex by design. In this category, Pokken gets a 10. Story. Like all fighting games, Pokken Tournament's story is not much to brag about. It is mostly there to help players advance their techniques and find a suitable fighting style. The player competes in league battles and wishes to rise through the ranks with the threat of Shadow Mewtwo looming over the characters' heads. In this aspect, Pokken gets a 7. Game modes. The game features a variety of play modes. The main story mode is the Ferrum League, a mode in which you enter battles to raise your Pokemon's level and to raise your rank within the league. The next mode is Free Battle, which allows you to participate in matches that don't affect your standing within the Ferrum League, but do get added to your overall win-loss record. Both the Ferrum League and Free Battles are designed as a means of developing newcomer skills. Then you have your competitive modes, with local multiplayer and online multiplayer. Online multiplayer breaks down into two categories, for fun and ranked battles. They're both pretty self-explanatory. Online multiplayer matchmaking is one of the positives this game has, connecting players to matches very quickly, and this is something of note. While online matches occasionally suffer from lag, it is nowhere near the amount of lag I deal with when playing Smash 4 and Splatoon. The servers being used for Pokken are much better, and it is a welcome change. There are plenty of modes within this game to keep players occupied. In this category, Pokken gets a 9. And what's the verdict? As I said earlier, Pokken Tournament seeks to serve many masters, and it succeeds in that goal in almost every way possible. Members of the FGC will find a deep metagame hidden behind adorable visuals. Pokemon fans will find themselves happy with the rock-paper-scissors mechanics that have made them love the franchise as a whole. And casual gamers will love the accessibility of the game. Pokken is a standout fighting game that I think will give Street Fighter V a run for its money. I can only hope the overall FGC sees the value of this game and helps build the community as strong as Street Fighter and Smash communities. That being said, the game doesn't need their support. It already is a hit. Pokken Tournament gets an 8.4. So, Mario After Party, what is your second opinion?
Well, I just have a few counterpoints that I would like to give in addition to your review. First off, I absolutely love the avatar customization in the game, especially when you can unlock titles and items for your avatar just by scanning amiibos through the game.
Yeah.
Just one more thing that you can use your amiibos for. And, you know, I'm all about customization, and it just is another feature of the game that I really love. Also, the system of rising through the ranks in each league that you compete in, it completely embodies the Pokemon trainer lifestyle, and it makes me feel like, you know, I'm a Pokemon trainer, you know, in real life. As much as any of the DS games ever did, I mean, this game just, it takes it to another level, and I really love that system that they have in the story mode. My biggest criticism, however, of the game is the online mode, which, if you want to play with your friends over the internet, there's no lobby for you to join them in. You have to select a friendly match and then create a fight password, and then both of you have to join the match within 10 seconds of each other, or else you'll end up playing a computer fighter. So that makes organizing matches online impossible without voice communication. So you'll definitely need to use your phone to facilitate them. But it also makes matches among groups of friends difficult as well. So, I especially found this annoying considering all of Nintendo's other high-profile titles that go online, such as Mario Kart 8, Smash 4, and Splatoon, don't have problems with this. There's a lobby for you to join your friends or an easy way for you to connect to your friends online. As far as the local multiplayer, though, there are some issues with how they're going to set up Pokken Tournament for the competitive scene that I wanted to bring up. Because with local multiplayer, only one player is going to be able to use the GamePro controller or the special edition controller that they came out.
The Pro Pack.
The, player will be forced to use the gamepad because there are no split screen options, and also because the game engine has to render two separate screens at the same time, the frames per second rate falls from 60 frames per second to 30 frames per second during local multiplayer. So, you know, if you compare that to a game like Smash, both of you can sit down on the same console and play against each other in a tournament, but you can't do that because that it's just the drop in the frame rate and the fact that both players can't use the controller that they want to use means that local multiplayer is not going to be an option for the competitive scene. So that leaves you with connecting over LAN. And to find this, and if you have Pokken Tournament and you're wondering how to get to LAN, it's a hidden mode within the game. To find it, you have to hold down L, R, and down on the D-pad before pressing start. And this takes you to the hidden LAN mode in Pokken Tournament. It's kind of a pain in the ass to set up, but that is the only way that they're going to be able to set up the tournament scene when they start having competitive tournaments for Pokken. The nice thing, though, is that everything is automatically unlocked. So if you just bought the game and you go into LAN mode, you can see all of the supporting Pokemon that you can use, and Mewtwo and Shadow Mewtwo are already unlocked.
Yeah, that's a feature that I thought that was sick, because you basically can set up a tournament without any major issues. So that was cool. That was my next question for you was, do you think that the larger FGC as a whole, will they gravitate towards this game? Of course, you just noted some of the negatives about setting it up, because yeah, it is a land-based game when you want to play it in a competitive mode. That being said, though, Nintendo has confirmed that every tournament that they're going to host and back and fund, they're going to have a minimum two-screen setup so that each player has their own screen. So it eliminates kind of like the side-by-side that we've had, you know, since the arcade era, which kind of bums me out. I mean, the arcade era, when you're standing or sitting next to somebody, the mind games are stronger, in my opinion. But even Street Fighter V has gravitated towards the two screen LAN setup versus, you know, the side by side. I mean, I think that part of competitive gaming might actually be over.
Maybe, but I will say, though, that the server that Pokken Tournament uses is probably the best server out of all of Nintendo's high-profile online games that I mentioned earlier. There are very little lag issues, and it's pretty reliable. If you know, you know, anybody that owns Splatoon knows what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
How unreliable and frustrating that server can be, you know, and Smash as well. Mario Kart 8, though, is probably on the same level as Pokken Tournament, but the server is really great. So when I play Nice One Online, you know, I don't have any issues, and I feel like we can both compete online against each other without any major problems, which is great. But the problem is, if I come over, you know, to your house and I want to play you, we're going to have to deal with one of us playing with the gamepad, and then we're going to have to deal with, you know, 30 frames per second. Because, or we could set up a LAN and I could bring my Wii U over, but that's the problem. It makes it difficult when you're in the same room. So there are some logistical issues with Pokken Tournament that will definitely need to be sorted out, or people are just going to have to get used to working around them if they want to play their friends. I mean, right now I would recommend, if you really want to play your friend, just go ahead and do it over the internet, over Wi-Fi, because that is probably the best option right now. But and I don't think that there will be an issue when they finally start doing competitive tournaments for Pockin, because LAN is pretty reliable.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, it's just not always, the setup is kind of a pain, but once it's set up, it works great. You know, and really those are my only criticisms of Pockin Tournament, just to kind of bring it all full circle. I love the game. The game mechanics, the fighting is fluid. It works. Field phase, dual phase. I mean, that just, it adds so much depth to the game. My review score would probably be about the same as yours. I might even give it a little bit higher. I really am surprised at how much I love this game. But to answer your question, I do think that the fighting game community will embrace it. Only time will tell for sure, but there's a lot of depth to this game. There's a lot of fun in this game, and you can tell that Nintendo put a lot of work into it, because it just, everything in this game just runs so smoothly, and hopefully they can work out some of the problems that are, you know, maybe by adding a lobby to the you know, online mode where you play with your friends. I feel like that should be an easy fix. I mean, maybe it's not, but you know, the game is pretty amazing, and I think that there's definitely going to be a lot of hype for it as we build up towards Evo in the summer.
Yeah, I agree with a couple of those points. What I like about it is there's a lot of depth hidden in this game. Like all fighting games, the game is only as advanced as you're willing to take it. If you're just going to sit there and play it casually, I mean, you're going to enjoy the game. You're not going to learn, you know, the finer mechanics. You're not going to be one of the greats. But, I mean, if you're just a casual or new to the fighting, you know, game community, then there is a hidden layer of deepness. Like, the game is really well balanced. I mean, my one real major criticism of this game really lies in the roster. With over 700 Pokemon to choose from, to limit it to 16, I mean, I said it in my review, it sucks. But still, there are a lot of cool things. And, you know, back to the FGC, Nintendo is finally getting their stuff together. They're supporting this right off the bat in ways that they never supported, you know, the Smash community. This game has had two tournaments, one invitational, and one GameStop tournament, you know, in the span of 7 months. We're going to have our first major tournament in Orlando at CEO. I will be going to compete. So, you know, Nintendo's footing the bill there. On top of that, they also announced that, you know, there's going to be a championship World Series, a championship series, CEO being a qualifier, Evo being a qualifier, and a prize pool of $100,000 to compete in Pokken. Smash does not have $100,000 prize pools.
No, and this game definitely got off to a running start, and I'm really happy that Nintendo's supporting it right away, too. But from the last thing that I read was that they didn't announce that they were going to come out with any DLC this, you know, for this game, for the roster, right?
Well, nothing's been confirmed. You know, the producer, the guy who he produces the Tekken series, said he's open to DLC.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, at least there's that. I mean, it's not like games can't be updated and patched and DLC exists. I mean, clearly, DLC... And it's not like they can't do it, because Smash has been the primer of what DLC can be. They built a full game, and then they built DLC characters after the game was built. So the mechanic is there. Like, you know, Bandai worked with Sakurai to make Smash for the last iteration. If they need Sakurai to just come in there and tell them how to add more characters, by all means, go talk to Sakurai, because it can be done.
Yeah, and I mean, I agree with you. The roster definitely is one of the things in the game that should be improved. It's kind of it's kind of light right now, but I'm not as worried about it because I have a feeling that we are going to get some DLC characters in this game, and I have a feeling we're going to get quite a few. I know they haven't confirmed anything yet, but, you know, Nintendo, if you're listening, Mario After Party's favorites would be Steelix or Infernape. I know that there are a lot of people out there. Everyone, I think one of the talking points with this game is that everybody has, like, one of their favorite Pokemon that they wish was in Pocket Tournament that's not. Everybody's got that one Pokemon like, oh man, I wish, you know, this Pokemon was in that game. So hopefully we'll start to see some of these Pokemon get added in. I mean, who would you like to see? Nice one.
Oh man, dude. Any one of the Hitmons would be sick for me. I want Hitmontop very specifically. But if you're going to give me any characters, give me one of the Hitmons. How did you ignore Hitmonchan or Hitmonlee? That's a misstep. These are like the two original fighting Pokemon. So I need a Hitmon in this game. Back to the DLC. I'm not worried about DLC because Tekken usually launches with about 16 characters. Usually. And then it ends up with a roster of about 47. So I'm really hoping that because the Tekken team made this game, that they're willing to put the same amount of effort into it. So many cool things to talk about. This game is amazing. There's one thing I do want to bring up. The transition between arcade to Wii U. This actually bothers me because I feel like it hurt the overall worldwide meta. This game launched in beta, you know, in beta in 2014, had a full launch in Japan in 2015. Dave and Buster's is going to start carrying them now that the game has had a home console release. Did Nintendo drop the ball with developing its meta by giving, you know, a whole country, you know, early access to this game, essentially? Or is that just, you know, a byproduct of the fact that arcades are dead in most countries other than Japan?
I think it's the latter. I mean, American players will catch up, and even if they had included it, how many, you know, it's not easy to find an arcade anymore like it used to be. Like, when we were kids, I mean, some of my fondest video game memories were just hanging out in the arcades and playing, like, Fatal Fury or, you know, Tekken. I mean, there's just, that just isn't part of the video game culture for this generation.
Dude, and I agree. And I'm the Street Fighter kid.
Yeah, Street Fighter was, I remember you talking about, you know, growing up playing those games. And I mean, I played Street Fighter on the console, really, not so much in the arcades. But yeah, it's just, I don't think if they had put it in the arcades, there would have been a lot of people that had access to it, because arcades just aren't popular anymore. So I don't think they dropped the ball. I think it's just a reflection of arcades aren't that big in America.
Yeah, but with the advent of locations like, you know, with the advent of Chuck E. Cheese's and Dave and Buster's for the adult market, I mean, arcades exist in some form. You know, like I said, Chuck E. Cheese, and then you have your adult entertainment arcades like Dave and Buster's. I go to Dave and Buster's pretty frequently. I'm going tomorrow. To me, it was a misstep. And had they, you know, had they announced a mass Pokken tournament arcade cabinet for Dave and Buster's, like, across the country, people would go because people are hungry for Pokemon. They've been hungry for Pokemon since 1998. I mean, it's a way to drum up business. It's a way to develop a meta. It's a way... I mean, the thing about the FGC as a whole is that the FGZ still lives in arcades. People still go to arcades to play Street Fighter. They still go to arcades to play Tekken. That's where they go to build the meta. That's where they go to begin the meta. They still exist. And they still hold that purpose. So I kind of think that the meta was hurt ever so slightly. It's not so significant, But I mean, Japan basically had 2 years to get good at this game. And to even further my point, I've had a bunch of online matches already, and every time I see somebody, I play somebody from Japan whose record is 0-0. I'm not getting bodied, but I'm getting beat. Even though they have a 0-0 record, they've never played online, they've never won a match online, but they've had that advanced time with the game, so they know the game. So that 0-0 record when you're playing somebody from Japan, it's not true. They have had matches. They've developed the meta. They know who they're going to play as. And trust me, I feel the pressure when I'm playing these people online. Like I said, my review still stands at an 8.4. I've had more time with the game, and I honestly think the 8.4 was justified. There are a lot of great positive things to say about this game. I can equally say that there are some negative things about this game, but the positives far outweigh the negatives, in my opinion, man. Final thoughts on the game?
No, I agree pretty much with most of your points. I think that the I gave it an 8.5. I think it could potentially go up to a 9.
Yeah.
With DLC, but we'll see how that plays out.
Yeah, I think the only question now is all that remains is how well these competitions do from here, to see whether or not the FGC truly embraces the game. All right. But let's go ahead and we'll move into our next segment. Amiibo acquisitions. Did you get anything new this month, bro?
I did. I got you the Japanese ROM.
Which I can't find anywhere here in Tampa, so thank you for that. I got a few. I got Lucas. I got Roy. I got Ryu. Hadouken!
Oh, I got Ryu. Yeah, I got Ryu for myself. So, yeah, I got Ryu.
Oh, dude, Ryu, that Ryu amiibo is sick, except for his feet.
You don't notice it that much. I mean, it's...
Yeah, it's not noticeable, but this is one of the few times where an amiibo didn't need a stand.
It's my favorite amiibo so far, I'll tell you that. I think I like it a little, I hate to say it, but I like it a little bit better than the Shulk amiibo. I think it's my favorite amiibo now.
Oh, dude. I love it, man. It really conveys, Ryu. And I love the finer details where he's even got the kanji on the gloves. I love how that came out. I also finally got Mega Yarn Yoshi. After, months and months of waiting for this damn amiibo. Toys R Us finally got a restock, and dude, I should have taken a picture of it, because the restock for this Mega Yarn Yoshi was tremendous. Although they're sold out again already at every Toys R Us in the Bay Area, so. Well, that's what we got with the amiibo acquisitions. Alright guys, so let's go ahead, we're going to move into our topic of the month, and like we said in the intro, our topic is, what's wrong with the Wii U? There are a lot of things that we can talk about here. We've got it down to some major bullet points. And we're going to start right at the launch. We're going to discuss the name, the pricing, and the launch lineup. So let's go ahead and begin with the name, which is probably one of the most damning contributing factors to what's wrong with the Wii U. The Wii came out in 2006, and a lot of people proclaimed that it was a toy. A lot of competitors, Sony called the Wii a toy, Microsoft called the Wii a toy, and as that console grew long in the tooth, I think that it actually kind of did become a toy. The longer it got, the games that were coming out, midway to the end of the console's lifespan, they weren't great. There are some notable exceptions, but the Wii was not living up to any more potential. It had exceeded its potential. So when they announced the new console being called the Wii U, an extension. When they launched the Wii, it was named the Wii because, first off, Wii can be phonetically said in every single language. And it was supposed to bring, you know, people back into, like, the living room, a device that we would all play. Now, with the Wii U, they wanted... The reason there's a U there is because they wanted to focus back on the single-player experience, or what we would consider hardcore games. Hardcore, using air quotes. But this is something that screwed the system. Like, what is the Wii U? Is it an addition to the Wii? Is it like an add-on? Is it an upgrade? Is it a new console entirely? I mean, physically, it looks like very similar to the Wii. A little, you know, a little bit sleeker. It kind of looks like a redesigned Wii. But in my opinion, this is a damning thing. At this is a juncture where Nintendo needed to step away from the Wii as a platform.
It was stupid. That's what it was.
Yeah, 100% agree. It was stupid. You needed to step away from the platform and regain consumer confidence.
Go ahead. I mean, it was retarded. Why would you name a system the same name as your old system? I don't care if there's a U at the end of it. Most people that are not hardcore gamers thought it was the same thing. I mean, you have a 3DS and a new 3DS, and they're the same thing, essentially. It's not a new portable gaming console. It's just an upgraded version, just like a 3DS and a 3DS XL. So when you come out with a Wii U, as a, you know, like, people are going to think that it's an add-on to a Wii. And I remember there are certain members of my family who are not gamers that when I would tell them, oh, I'm going to Nice One's place, we're going to play the Wii U, they're like, oh, you mean the Wii? I'm like, no, the Wii U. They're like, is it the same thing? No, it's not the same thing. And to them, it's because the names are so similar, you know, there are probably, you know, a lot of parents out there that were like, well, that's probably, I don't need to buy a Wii U, I have a Wii. Why would I, you know, it didn't separate itself enough from the generation before it. It didn't stand out and say, hey, I'm different, I'm better, you need to buy me. And it was just, whoever thought of that name should be fired.
Yeah, and even to the point where President Kimishima said something along the lines that this system would fail because of the name. I mean, he predicted that before it launched, and it's kind of new. It's kind of new news to us now, but he did say that we need to separate ourselves from this console. We need to move forward. That being said, the next major issue I have with the console, right at the bat off of the launch, is there were two separate entry points. There was the Wii U, the 8-gig edition that was white, the basic edition, they call it the basic set. And then you have your deluxe set, which had 32 gigs of memory, and that's the all black edition. And the price difference between the two was from $399 to $349. That's a $50 difference to essentially quadruple your memory space. And that being said, 32 gigs still isn't a lot. I can fill up a 32 gig iPhone in a week. I mean, 32 gigs of video games?
That's impressive.
Like, 32 gigs of video games is an abortion. It is not good. Like, to have to add an external hard drive, like, I would be more accustomed to buying digital games if I wasn't scared that I was going to fill up my hard drive space. If it weren't for that, I'd have more digital games. As it stands, I've got a few, like, retro games, and I've got the Wind Waker HD digital, but I don't really go out and, you know, download games onto my Wii U because I'm not trying to fill up that tiny hard drive. And then, you know, the price points, that sucks. That sucks so bad. Well, there's this version in white for $399, and there's this version for $350. Separating your entry points has never been a good thing. I mean, it works for Apple, but people who buy computers have different needs than people who buy video game consoles. You know, most people want to buy the console that's cheapest, but then there's a backlash when it comes to the Wii U for buying the cheaper version.
I mean, they're two completely different markets. You know, you can't look at the console market and try to, you know, mimic it to the computer market or PC market, or, you know, you really can't. But in the scheme of things, I don't think that the separate entry points really ended up hurting it in the long run too much. It might have made for a confusing launch, but you know, when we're discussing what's wrong with the Wii U, man, I mean, there are a few of the points that we're gonna bring up that really, in my opinion, there are two main things that really killed the system.
You see, but for me, I'm one of those people who likes to buy his consoles, if I can, white. To be forced to buy a black edition because of hard drive limitations, it sucks for me. Like, I would rather have everything, you know, my consoles be white. I think everything looks better white. I don't know why. Just, you know, when it comes to technology. I want my iPhone white, I want my Samsung Gear white, I want my iPad white, and I want a white Wii, but I don't want 8 gigs of memory on a white Wii.
I mean, I don't have as much of a preference with the color, but I mean, that's a good point. You know, you should be able to buy a black or a white Wii with the same amount of memory. That would be ideal, for sure.
Alright. Moving on to the launch lineup. I have severe issues with the launch lineup. Mind you, that this is the first Nintendo console to launch with a Mario game basically since the 64. Like, we had two home consoles that didn't launch with a Mario game. So plus for the Wii U launching with a Mario game. But here are the other launch titles that came out. Call of Duty Black Ops 2, Skylanders Giants, Transformers Prime, Wipeout 3, Epic Mickey 2, FIFA 13, Tekken Tag Tournament, Ninja Gaiden and Razor's Edge, Nintendo Land, Sing Party, Sonic and All-Star Racing Transformed, Warriors Orochi 3, Darksiders 2, Assassin's Creed 3, ESPN Sports Connection, Just Dance 4, Rabbids Land, Your Shape Fitness Evolved, Zombie U, Scribblenauts Unlimited, Game Party Champions, and Batman Armored Edition, the Arkham City game. This is what kills me about the launch lineup. So, Nintendo initially launches with some pretty heavy third-party support. It launches with heavy third-party support. But the games that are coming out had been out for years. Batman Arkham City had been out for a year. Assassin's Creed had been out for a year. Call of Duty had been out for a year. These are games that people don't necessarily buy a Nintendo console for, and we're getting the older editions. Probably not the best way to launch a console with old games that people probably already have and might be deterred from buying this console because they're not getting anything new from the third party. That's got to be, you know, dissuasive. On top of that, the rest of the games, most of them aren't good. I mean, Nintendo Land was a pretty fun game if you have people to play games with, you know, because that game is, you know, a party game. It's fun. It's a really good game. Zombie U was like a crowning achievement because it's a third party who understood how to use the gamepad right off the bat. That game is really hard and dark, so not necessarily designed to be played by younger children, but it was a step in the right direction, but it wasn't like the launch lineup we needed. And even though I applauded Nintendo for having a Mario game at launch, it wasn't, you know, when we get Mario games on home consoles, we expect these giant games, since, you know, Mario 64 really set a tone for where the Mario franchise is going. And this system launched with New Super Mario Bros. U, which is, you know, harkening back to the old 2D Mario games. It's not a bad game. It's actually a really good game. But also keep in mind, that when that game came out, there was a Mario 2, there was a Mario game like that on the 3DS that had come out like a month prior. So you had two games in that in the Mario franchise that were almost identical, like launching at the same time.
I remember that. I remember thinking, this game just came out for the Wii. Why would I want to buy it again for the Wii U? I know it was a different game, but I mean, essentially, it was just another throwback game to the retro style of, you know, side-scrolling Mario. But
you know, and to you know, to go further with the way the Wii U launched, when the Wii U launched, you know, third parties were on board. They were like hype for the Wii U, you know, and that gave Nintendo a little bit of confidence. But because of that, games like Wii Fit U, which isn't really a game, but it, you know, people enjoyed those games. And you know, the Wonderful 101, which was made by Platinum, which is an awesome game that anybody who owns a Wii U should have. That game was delayed. Pikmin 3, which is one of Nintendo's, you know, key franchises, that game was delayed. And so was Game & Wario. So this starts a bad trend of Nintendo delaying games. And it kind of made sense because they had third-party support to delay games when it launched. But as the console grew older, these delays become a problem. We'll talk about that more later. Let's move on to the lack of third-party support.
Yes, that's a and for me, I think that is arguably the biggest reason why Nintendo did not succeed with the Wii U. And I know we're gonna get to the delayed titles shortly, but when you have a strong stream of third-party titles being released, it doesn't put as much pressure on the first-party game developers to come out with those games on time, because then it's okay to have a delayed first-party title if you've got two or three third-party titles that are kind of high-profile titles that are being pushed out. Then everyone doesn't notice the delays as much, or the delays don't affect the console as severely. So for me, the fact that, you know, most third-party companies abandoned the Wii U is that was a huge thing for Nintendo.
Yeah, and it kind of starts with Ubisoft, or however you say that name. Ubisoft, they had games already made for the Wii U, but because the console wasn't selling as much as they initially thought it would, Ubisoft decided to hold off games like Watch Dogs and Rayman Legends, which Rayman sold amazing on the Wii when they brought that franchise back to its like previous glory. You know, moving away from the Rabbids and going back to the regular Rayman. You know, they started pulling games, and the Rayman Legends was initially going to be a Wii U exclusive title, but because the Wii U wasn't selling, it wasn't moving the needle, that game became, you know, a multi-console game. You know, you can buy that on the Xbox One. You can buy it on the PS, you know, the PS4. You know, that kills what fan base can be developed. When, you know, when you split your fan base between three consoles, it's gonna one console is gonna suffer. And in this case, the Wii U suffered because now you have a marquee game from a third party developer not coming out exclusively on your console.
And I'm sorry to interrupt. I agree though with Ubisoft's reasoning, because when they say that you know, Nintendo customers don't buy Assassin's Creed, it's kind of true. Nintendo customers, because Nintendo skews to a younger demographic, Ubisoft, their mature games were not selling well on the Wii, and they realized that, you know, they could put out Assassin's Creed for a Nintendo console and a Sony console, and it would sell amazingly on a PlayStation, but it wouldn't sell hardly at all on a Wii. And so they realized they were kind of losing money developing these mature games for Nintendo. So I kind of agree with the reason why they didn't want to develop games for Nintendo, because most of their games are mature.
Yeah. So that's, it starts with Ubisoft. And then quickly afterwards, EA follows suit. EA stops making games. Now, EA is probably, what are they, the second largest video game company after Activision Blizzard? EA, they make Madden, The Sims, Call of Duty, Battlefield. There are so many games that EA has that are marquee, big, giant games. And losing, especially just losing the Madden franchise, just losing Madden can hurt consoles. Madden is an established franchise. It is as important to home consoles as real football is to television. What Madden does for consoles is very akin to what the NFL does for people who watch TV. Losing that franchise alone, that hurts. But then losing games like Call of Duty and all these other really good games that they produce, it's like a nail in the coffin. It's like the first nail in the coffin of the death of the Wii U. This losing, man, I love the Madden series. I'm not a big Call of Duty fan, but I understand the value that that game has, and I understand what it means, you know, to consoles to have that franchise right off the bat. And again, you know, EA said something different, though. They basically complained that it was hard to develop for the Wii U. That development on the Wii U, the games that Nintendo make, they're brilliant because Nintendo has, like, all the access to the system. Like, they can do whatever they want, and they can push the system to the limits. But they don't give that same ability to the third parties. And I think what even further hurts that is that third parties just, they had already moved on to the Xbox One and the PS4. And, you know, to go into another topic, you know, the hardware on the Wii U was really like going back to where the PS3 and the Xbox 360 were. Like, you couldn't cross-develop a game for all three consoles. You would have to make a PS4 version, an Xbox One version, and then after the fact, try to make a Wii U version. So because the console was running off of last-gen hardware and the new gen was at the precipice, it was too difficult to keep making games for the Wii U because they don't want to go backwards, they want to go forwards. They want to go and use the newest technology. They want to advance what their games look and feel like. And the Wii U just didn't offer that. Whew. Anything you have to say on that?
You know, I just feel like if the Wii U was selling the same kind of numbers that the Wii was, I think EA Sports would change their tune. And I think that, you know, they were, I mean, I get it. You don't want to, it's easier to develop something for the PlayStation and then transfer to the Xbox and vice versa, just because those systems are more similar and they don't have a radically different controller between them that you're going to have to develop a totally, you know, different part of the game for. But, you know, they kind of screwed Nintendo a little bit, and I feel like their reasoning for it was just lazy. Like, we don't want to develop games because it's different.
Yeah, I mean, at some point, though, I have to think that they're justified. I mean, first off, the console isn't really selling. I mean, it's been out, we're beginning our fourth year with the console, and in this time, it's only moved about 12.8 million units. It's not a very large number when it comes to, like, consoles in general. And it's very far off of what the Wii was doing. But then, you know, these companies can't really make the next Assassin's Creed. They can't really make the next Watch Dogs. And it's a hindrance to go back. I mean, these developers have moved forward, and it's a, you know, it's a damn shame, but it is what it is. I mean, that's the way that consoles work. You know, personally, I don't, you know, maybe I would want, you know, the Assassin's Creed series, but it is what it is. I mean, I'm just losing the third parties really, really, really stabbed the Wii U right in the chest.
Yeah, it did. It was difficult because it just reduced the library for it. You don't have as many games, and if they're not offering as many games as the other consoles, we know that, you know, looking at previous consoles throughout history, like PlayStation 2, I mean, it dominated just because nobody could. I mean, there were more than one reason why, you know, multiple reasons why it dominated, but no one could compete with its library. The library of games that the PlayStation 2 had would just dwarf anything that Microsoft or Sony could come up with. And when even if you have great games for your system, if you don't have those, you know, average to slightly above average games to like kind of fill it in to try to broaden the market of your console, you know, it's going to be difficult when you're relying on, you know, just a few big games to sell your system. Because if those games flop, then you don't have a backup plan.
That's 100% true. Moving on to our next point. This one's a biggie. The image with the hardcore gamers. I can't count anymore how many times when people ask me if I'm a gamer, what console I play, and I say the Wii U, and they're like, "What? Why?" It's almost like they're mocking me, like for owning the console. But then they're like, "What games do you even play?" I mean, now I can obviously say Smash, Mario Kart, Splatoon, Pokken. You know, they're like, the library is big, you know, I got my Mario games, but they're always going to counter me with something like PlayStation owners are going to counter me with, well, what about Drake's Uncharted, or what about Metal Gear Solid, you know, what about, you know, Watch Dogs or Quantum Break or all these big marquee games that they have on their consoles that seem to come out in drones, or, you know, like we were talking about earlier, what about Madden, what about FIFA? What about all these games? And I'm like, well, then I have to counter back with, well, I don't really play a lot of those games because, with the exception of Madden, none of them really interest me. I mean, Madden and Uncharted, obviously, on the PlayStation, but, like, an Uncharted game is like a Mario game for that system. That being said, like, I can counter as, like, well, if you play the games that I'm talking about, these are amazing games. Like, you know, obviously, Smash sells systems. Mario Kart sells systems. Splatoon ended up selling systems. And Pokken might sell systems. Which is going to be hard because I don't know if you got the report that apparently Nintendo was ceasing production on the Wii U this year. Like, they're not making anymore. And
yep, read it. I read it.
Yeah, and with a game like Pokken just coming out, This is something that could potentially move the Wii U. So I'm really hoping that there's a real nice backlog of Wii U somewhere in a facility. Just, hey, we have these systems. Let's move them. Because there's this amazing game that's selling really well. Let's put more systems out. But if they really do cease production on the Wii U, that's bad. But, you know, back to the image with the hardcore gamers, you know. We don't get those games. We don't get Metal Gear Solid, we don't get Uncharted, and the few M-rated games that we do get aren't very good. So, you know.
I had, you know, a similar experience. I was at work, and, you know, one of my coworkers was like, "Oh, so what system do you have?" And I'm like, "Oh, I have a Wii U." And he's like, "Oh, okay." And I'm like, I mean, that, you know, I could already tell he was judging me by his voice, and you know, it was so condescending, and I'm just like, man, have you even played some of these games that are on that system? No. Like, you know, he's like, well, what games are even on that system? I'm like, man, have you not played Smash Bros? He's like, oh, I played that before for the Wii or the 64. I'm just like, yeah, and you got Smash, you got Mario Kart, you got Splatoon. The games on that the system does have are pretty amazing, but people judge you, especially if they're, you know, like, I would say over 18, and you tell somebody you have a Wii U, they're like, oh, like, you're not one of the cool kids anymore.
Yeah, it's like you're the brunt of a really bad joke. It's like when somebody tells a racist joke, and you're part of the race that they're telling the joke about.
But, you know, I think Nintendo is definitely trying to fix their image. Pokken Tournament, I think, will go a long way towards that, because when people, realize that it's one of those games that's a staple in the fighting game community, people might give the Wii U or Nintendo a little more credit. Because I think Pokken is going to do more for Nintendo's image than Smash will.
That's true. I mean, it's a fighting game based on Pokemon. To take it one step further, Pokken Tournament's better than Street Fighter V currently. Like,
yeah, I mean, it's, you know, it is, and especially if, you know, you look at the story mode. I mean, Street Fighter V barely has a story mode at all. At least Pokken Tournament, you're not going to get the same depth of story as you would with, like, I guess Mortal Kombat X or Blaze Blue, but it's the story mode is fun and it's enjoyable, and at least there are way more game modes and to offer you with Pokken Tournament than Street Fighter V. And I'm not saying Street Fighter V is a bad game by any means, but it's kind of like an incomplete game in my opinion.
Yeah, and I wholeheartedly agree with that. It is what it is. I mean, there are potential games that could really bring forward some, like, the last hurrah that the system could have. There are still games coming that could breathe life into the system, but we might never know. Moving on, this is my biggest issue. This is an issue that plagues me. The Nintendo Network. I want to start this by saying that the 3DS has a great online infrastructure, and the DS had a great online infrastructure. Let's move to the first thing that the Wii U gets wrong, is that its network infrastructure doesn't support voice. No voice Yep. communication. I mean, there is a separate app on the Wii U for you to make live phone calls, you know, like Skype calls. Yet for some reason that doesn't work in game. It's to exit out of a game to call somebody on the Wii U and stop, you have to completely stop playing the game, and then no voice communication. That's kind of a deal breaker. If the PlayStation came out without voice control, guarantee you the PlayStation is done.
I mean, I totally agree, and I understand Nintendo wants to keep their family-friendly image, but man, you have got to allow voice communication at least between people who have already shared their friend codes. If I am friends with you and I'm already connected to you, you know, through our Wii U's, I should be able to communicate at least with my friends at the minimum.
Yeah, I mean, look how many systems it took for us to get, you know, gamer tags to find a friend with a gamer tag versus the friend codes. That took too damn long to transition. To go even further, the network itself has been pretty bad. I cannot tell you how many times I play Splatoon and have been either lag killed or booted from rooms. I have, you know, and Splatoon is a game where if you play online, you know, you have your turf war for fun, and you have your rank mode to level up and, you know, be competitive at Splatoon. I have lost so many rank points just from being booted off of the server.
Splatoon is going to give me an aneurysm. I mean, that game, as much as I love it, and as much as it was game of the year for me last year, oh my god, has that game pissed me off more than any other game probably in the history of video games. Like, the amount of times that Nice One and I have been playing online where one of us has been booted totally screws our rank, because if you play Splatoon, you know that winning a 3-on-4 match is like, you know, once in a blue moon. So once one of your teammates gets booted, man, it's game over. And everybody's rank gets screwed over because of it. And, I mean, I can't tell you how many times we have been booted from a room and just constantly screwed over right when we're about to rank up. And it may not seem like a big deal at first, but when you think about it, let's say you're at, you know, an A rank with 50 points. Well, if you win, let's say you would have won a match that would have given you 10 points, but you got booted, and so you lost 10 points. Well, now you're sitting at 40 points instead of 60 because of one match. That's a 20-point spread. And when that happens multiple times, you are screwed. And my rank right now in Splatoon, which I think it's an A, would probably be an S rank, at least an S minus, had I not constantly been screwed by the server over and over and over again, or had teammates that I've been playing with get booted because they got screwed. I mean, Nintendo has definitely got to fix their server issues, which is why I'm so happy that at least Pokken's server is reliable, because yeah, Splatoon fucking pisses me off, dude, more than any game.
But Pokken has been... They're using a Bandai server, which is why it's so fluid. They're using their... It's not a Nintendo server. Using Bandai server, and because they're a third-party company, and they... You know, if their online games don't work, they're screwed. They're screwed. If a third party's online functions don't work, they're screwed. So they didn't even use Nintendo's network. They're using their servers. On top of that, I love Smash Bros. I love Smash Bros. That game is unplayable online. At certain times, if you're playing anytime from 10 p.m. to 6 a.m., that game is unplayable because of the lag.
Yeah, I would say so too. It's Smash is a little bit better because at least you're not getting booted from a fight. But you know, there are definitely too many times where I've had lag issues playing online with Smash. But you know, Nintendo got it right with Mario Kart. I feel like there is potential. I know they can get it right again. They just need to, you know, make sure that when they come out with the NX, that they secure whatever online servers that they're using and completely test them out for any issues so that we don't have these problems again. Because Splatoon is such an amazing game, and it just kills me that you are constantly, you know, it's ruining the experience because of a server issue, which has nothing to do with the game developers, because they developed the great game. It's the server that the game is being played on, which is, you know, causing me to be, you know, have sleepless nights and swear at my TV and just... But anyway, I mean, yeah, moving on.
This is another huge factor. First-party delays.
I would say that for me is probably the second biggest reason why the Wii U was unsuccessful, because it just ties into that lack of third-party support. First-party delays are definitely magnified, and they become a lot more important to the console, because then you can't have these delays, because it's so important to continue the stream of releasing your games. And when you start having first-party delays with no third-party support, you know, you just it's kind of like a snowball effect. It's like, well, we don't have these other companies releasing games for us, so now we have to release this game on time. But if it's delayed, then it's a big news story, and it shouldn't have to be that way.
And it's true. And this trend started early. We brought it up with the launch. Nintendo delayed key games at launch because they had the third-party support. Nintendo severely underestimated how hard it is to develop high-definition games. And they've gone on record, and they've stated that, so we know that it's true. But the trend didn't get better, because when you had the third-party support, you could kind of get away with it. You could. But now it's gone, and you are delaying. The entire story of 2015 is delays. Mario Maker was delayed, but it came out in 2015. Zelda was delayed, and we still don't know when that game is coming out. Zelda Wii U is probably the biggest game that the Wii U has left to offer, and it's been pushed back. And, you know, it's nice that they came out with Twilight Princess in HD. Love it. I bought the game. I'm enjoying it. It's my second playthrough of that game because I haven't played it since the Wii. But I love that game on the Wii. And it's nice that there's like a stopgap. But damn it, I just want my Zelda. I want my Zelda. The same thing happened to the GameCube. The same thing happened to the Wii. Skyward Sword on the Wii was delayed. And it came out in 2011, right as the Wii U was pushing itself out, right as the Wii was pushing itself out the door, and it became like the swan song. And now, you know, Zelda U is also seeming like it's going to be the last hoorah for the Wii. For the Wii U. Yep.
That one hurt. That, I think, hurt the Wii U more than any other game being delayed.
And Star Fox, let's go ahead and get into Star Fox. Now, Star Fox doesn't have the same clout as Zelda, but Star Fox, you know, is still a key franchise to Nintendo. Despite the missteps, it's still a key franchise to Nintendo. And, you know, yeah, in the long run, delaying Star Fox made it, from what I've seen, it looks much better than what we saw at E3 last year. But still, delaying Star Fox, because Star Fox was a holiday game, when you move the most consoles, delaying Star Fox was so stupid. Was so stupid. I mean, yeah, it's better. It looks better now. But damn it. Losing Star Fox. And I'm a huge Star Fox fan. Huge. To lose that series, you know, which hasn't really had a great game in a while. And when they finally go back to what made the franchise great, to have to find out that it's been delayed to another year, that sucks. That's just not acceptable. These delays are no longer acceptable. At this point, I almost just wish Nintendo would stop announcing games.
I know, it's a shame. And, you know, I agree. Star Fox it's an important franchise. When you look at the franchises Nintendo has that move consoles, people buy consoles for Mario Kart. That is a huge franchise, and that was really when the Wii U sales finally started to pick up when they released Mario Kart 8. And it's the same with Zelda. People buy consoles for Zelda. There is a group of diehard Zelda fans out there who probably haven't purchased a Wii U yet because Nintendo hasn't come out with a new Zelda game for it. And that is a big market. Splatoon is starting to become that way now. I think with Splatoon 2, you'll see people that will purchase an NX just for Splatoon. But, you know, when it comes to Mario Kart and Zelda, those franchises are so popular that you almost have to have them on every single system. And not having Zelda on the Wii U has really hurt. I mean, that one, and I'm not even that big of a Zelda fan. I like the Zelda game, but just from a marketing standpoint, that one hurt Nintendo pretty badly.
Yeah. Moving forward, I mean, you segued me into this perfectly. Marketing. I went back and I YouTubed the launch commercial for the Wii U, and it's freaking god awful. It's a bunch of people in like a giant cube. You know, it's a bunch of families playing Wii U games, but they're not really showing like what the Wii U was actually capable of. So your marketing was right off the bat weird, and the marketing didn't really focus on the gamepad. We did not know what the gamepad was for. We didn't know if it was essential. I mean, yeah, it comes with the console. But, I mean, and this is a problem that the Wii U still has. It's like, what does the gamepad do other than display maps? Or even a game like Splatoon, which utilizes the gamepad pretty flawlessly, it pretty much functions as a map. And, you know, your ability to super jump, it doesn't really function. I mean, and, you know, the motion controls, I mean, which, you know, some people swear by, but they don't really work. It's not like anything that the 3DS wasn't doing, you know, 12 years ago. I'm sorry, the DS. I mean, basically, you know, the DS's marketing, when they launched with the DS, you know, they had this great slogan, touching is good, is what the slogan was. Really putting emphasis on that bottom screen, you know, on the dual screen aspect of the DS. Now, the Wii U is essentially a giant DS or 3DS, and they have not nearly marketed it as well as what they did the DS. And all of this ties into the non-educated consumer, because a non-educated consumer, if they're not confused by the name, they're definitely confused about what the gamepad is and what it does. Like, these people who just buy consoles for their children, they don't know what they're buying. I was at Toys R Us 2 days ago, and somebody was trying to buy Skylanders for their grandchild. And they didn't know which system they had, and they physically had to call their grandchild while the line keeps growing longer and longer. They had to call their grandchild to confirm if they had a Wii or a Wii U. That's bad marketing. That is bad marketing. When the average consumer doesn't know the difference between your consoles, you fucked up.
Yeah, and it's just, and that ties into the name. You know, the name did not differentiate this generation from the previous one. It didn't stand out enough, and now you have a marketing issue with it not even, you know, like you said, it's the uneducated consumer, and they don't know why the system is better or different or how you're supposed to use this gamepad. I mean, you know, you said it perfectly.
You know, and the worst part about the gamepad is that I fear that the NX is tied to the gamepad for things like amiibo support. Having amiibo support in the gamepad, you know, the NFC reader, that might limit the next generation of hardware, because now you have a whole brand new platform that is actually succeeding. Like, Nintendo gets something right in this generation with amiibo, and now they might be tied to some type of gamepad type controller because of it.
Well, how are you going to play Splatoon without a gamepad? I mean, they could change Splatoon 2 to work without one, but you cannot play Splatoon without a gamepad.
It's true, yeah. I mean, like, there are games and franchises and amiibo that are tied to what the gamepad is and does, and that's a scary concept for whatever the NX is, because it's tied to some kind of tablet controller. That's not a good look. And, I mean, I think that's all I have to say on the topic. Do you have anything else you want to bring up there?
Nope.
All right. So now let's move on to something that, you know, it's actually kind of a boon, but it's still something that's wrong. Too little, too late. By the time we started getting games like Mario Kart or 3D Mario World or Splatoon, Mario Maker, Smash, the console was already a laughing stock. You know what I'm saying? There was nobody who had appreciated the Wii because they had no reason to appreciate the Wii U. So when the good games start coming out, nobody gives. Nobody cares. And it's just too little too late. And you've already burned bridges with your third party. You've already burned bridges with the consumer. Who, you know, it's a comedy of errors that lead us to this point. When the good games start coming out, they don't move the needle because people are trading in their consoles or they're not even buying them. Like, it's just too little too late. And on top of the delays, by the time Zelda Wii U comes out, we might know what the NX is. Like, that's a possibility. That's a reality.
It's a possibility that it might not come out. It's a possibility that we might not get a new Zelda game for this console. They may just put it out on the NX, because at this point in time, you have got about 9 months left. Well, probably not even 9 months. Less than 9 months until the NX drops.
You know, even if it comes out next year, at the very least, in order to build consumer confidence and shareholder confidence, you have to show the system. Like, they have to show the system. Which, in turn, once the system is revealed, you're not selling another Wii U. You're done. Like, it's too little too late, because now we're on the precipice of a new console. And it's just too little too late. And that moves us over to the next point, is the NX. This time last year, Nintendo, they had a conference. And they had a shareholders meeting. Within that shareholders meeting, they discussed things like Amiibo. They discussed that they were moving to mobile. But the last thing that they discussed very briefly was codename NX, a new home console. 3 years after the launch of the Wii U, they're announcing new hardware. This is basically, without actually saying it, Nintendo was saying that the Wii U is a failed system and they have to move forward. They have to move on to the next system, and they have to do it quickly, because it's not happening. The Wii U is not selling, and now we hear all these rumors day in, day out about what the NX is, you know, what the NX is going to be. And of course, the article that came out this week that the Wii U is ceasing production further puts the NX into the limelight even further, because why would they stop making a console? Why would they stop production on a console? Because they have a new one in the pipeline, and they're going to be manufacturing that console instead of the Wii U. It's, you know, whatever the NX is, we still have no clue what the NX is. Whatever it is the final nail in the Wii U coffin.
I mean, I feel like it's like the Game of Thrones. The NX is coming. That is, you know, that's like the only thing I can think of now every time I hear that, because they don't even have a slogan for it. It's just, the NX is coming.
And I think that's it. So I'm going to hit you with my closing thoughts. I know this episode seems really negative. It seems really negative, and in truth, it is. This is a negative episode. I mean, there is not a lot that we can, you know, we said everything that we had to say about this system. Now, that being said, I love my Wii U. I really do. It is the best system Nintendo has ever released. And the library of actual Nintendo games is amazing. Like, the games that are good are so good. Mario Maker is one of the most brilliant games I have ever played. Splatoon is so addictive. Smash Bros. Is evergreen, and it's always keeping that franchise alive. The system alive. Pokken Tournament is a game that can completely change the landscape of the fighting game community, you know, and it's something that Nintendo can put money behind. There are these great, great games on this system, and I love my Wii U, and I would make that purchase again every day. You know, I just wish that the console had been better to me as a consumer. I'm a diehard Nintendo fan, and I will ride for them. And I will defend Nintendo with my dying breath. But at the end of the day, like, the console just didn't give me the things that they promised us when they unveiled it. And that's all I have to say on the matter. Mario After Party, you got anything?
I think it's important that, you know, we give our honest opinions about things. I love Nintendo, and I think the Wii U is a great system, but there were definitely some problems with it. And you know, it's unfortunate because this system has released some of the greatest new intellectual property Nintendo has ever created. You're going to look back on this system and, you know, realize that it gave birth to Splatoon and Pokken Tournament. Even though Pokken Tournament was around in the arcades before, this is the first console that it appeared on. And those two games, I think, are going to have a huge impact in the years to come, especially when you start releasing the second and third iterations of those games, because those games are going to move the needle for Nintendo in the future. And then also you have Amiibo, which Nintendo hit the jackpot with, and that is also something that's going to be associated with the Wii U. And people are going to look back on this console in the years to come, and they're going to wonder why it didn't succeed when it had all these great things going for it, especially if the gamepad catches on with the NX, you know, if they do include it with the NX, which I kind of have a feeling they are. But, you know, for me, this is arguably my favorite system that Nintendo has ever come out with. At least it's up there for me with the Super Nintendo. I mean, between the Super Nintendo and the Wii U, I can't remember the last time I've had so much fun with a Nintendo console.
I agree.
But, you know, as, you know, all the points that we've addressed why this system wasn't successful, you know, it's a shame because a lot of the reasons were, you know, marketing issues or, you know, a lack of third-party support or a reputation amongst hardcore gamers. But when you look at the actual games that Nintendo has released for this console and the, you know, the Toys to Life series behind it, and I mean, there are some games here that it's funny that people say that, you know, Nintendo doesn't appeal to the hardcore gamer, because you look at Pokken Tournament, you know, Smash 4 and Splatoon, and all three of those games have competitive tournament scenes. And, yeah. You know, I mean, Nintendo pretty much rules Evo this year. You know, in 2016, Nintendo has 3 out of the 9 games at Evo,
yeah,
which is a fighting game tournament. And Nintendo has more games than any other company there, and people still think that Nintendo doesn't appeal to the hardcore gamer. Well, you know, that's not true. And Nintendo, I think they're going to get it right with the NX. I think they'll learn from their mistakes, but the Wii U was like the console that just never was. And it's frustrating because it was such a great console. But, you know, those are my final thoughts. I think it's a shame, but, you know, moving on to the future, I think the NX will rectify those mistakes, and I think they will learn from them.
Yeah, I agree. All right, guys, before we get out of here, we want to shout out our contest winner for episode 6, Amy G. She sent us a great letter. I'm not going to read the entire letter, Amy. It's a little long, but you did address something in the letter that I think it needed to be addressed. We asked, what was your favorite generation of Pokemon? And Amy G, she wrote, in response to the contest, my favorite Pokemon game is Crystal, as it is the first game where you could play as a girl. And when I went on my Pokemon journey as a female for the first time, I felt like I was connecting to the game in a way that I hadn't in the first generation or in Gold and Silver at the time. That meant the world to me. Amy, I had never thought about what it was like for female gamers to constantly play as, you know, the male archetype. You know, Mario After Party and I, after we got the email, we actually had a real discussion on what it's like for female gamers, especially, you know, in the Pokemon franchise, which kind of skews to children and females. You know, we never thought about what ramification it had that these little girls and teenage girls and, you know, even adult girls, what the ramifications were that they had to, play as a male character, so I thought you brought up a really valid point, and for that, you win the Pokemon prize pack. Mario After Party, you have anything to say to Amy G?
Yeah, Amy G, your letter was awesome. You definitely brought up some really interesting points, and, you know, one of my, you know, all-time rivals in Pokemon is my little sister, and I never even realized that it took Nintendo to Gen 3 to allow you to play as a girl, and that is just, I mean, it's mind-blowing, and, you know, you definitely, you know, your letter really brought up some great issues kind of in the video game industry as a whole with that, and, you know, I really enjoyed your letter, so thank you very much.
Thank you. And again, I want to thank you again for, you know, commenting on our brand new music. We got that from the remix album Splatoons, and that was provided to us from, you know, GameChops.com, and, you know, DJ Cutman was very nice enough to allow us to use that music. So thank you so much, Amy G, for commenting on the music. We love it. It's our new music, and we're going to stick with it. We hope you enjoy, and we plan to use more tracks from that remix album in our transitions and in our openings and in our closings. So thank you, Amy G. Go ahead and hit me back up with the email and with all your information. We're going to get that prize pack sent out to you. Guys, that's going to be our show for today, at least this half of the show. There is still another half of the show that you guys are going to get to listen to. It is an interview with Blake J. Harris, the author of the New York Times best-selling book, Console Wars. You know, I'm always looking for ways to make this show better. And, you know, Mario After Party is right there with me. We want to make this the best possible listening experience for people. And we got Blake J. Harris, and he was gracious enough to give us some of his time. This is a busy dude. This guy has his hands in film. He's making a feature film about the book. He's making a documentary about the book. And he's currently working on his next book. We're going to discuss that book, that movie, that documentary, and his next book in this interview. It is a great conversation I had with him. You guys are really going to enjoy it. So go ahead, listen to that half. I promise you, it is everything that I'm saying that it is. So, without further ado, we're going to go ahead and we're going to say deuces. And you guys can go ahead and catch us on the next episode, all right? Anything else, man? You're off the party.
Stay fresh.
Stay fresh. Welcome to the Splat Zones. We are a monthly video cast slash podcast dedicated to bringing you the best Nintendo-related topics. And today, we are bringing you a very special segment of the podcast. It is our first ever interview. But before I introduce our very special guest, I want to explain the how and the why this interview came to be. This interview is the brainchild of something Mario Party and myself talk about and passing a lot on the Splat Zones, and that's the console wars of the 90s. It was an era when one army dominated the market and another defiantly stood to challenge. It was all-out war, and the two generals who led the troops, Mario on one side, Sonic the Hedgehog on the other. The battlegrounds of this war, schoolyards, playgrounds, cafeterias, and the soldiers who fought bravely were the youth of 90s America. The winner of this war would ultimately define the future of video games as we know them now, so the stakes were very high. I have with me today Blake J. Harris, the man who would chronicle the events of this war in his amazing book, Console Wars, Sega, Nintendo, and the Battle That Would Define a Generation. I don't want to take up too much of your time. First off, I do want to say, huge fan of the book. Awesome book.
Thank you. It was my first book, and therefore my favorite book. But no, it was you know, I grew up during that era, so writing the book for me was, you know, it had a lot of personal value, and I'm so glad that it has been enjoyed by readers like yourself.
No, yeah, it's a great book, and it's, I like how it stands out in a market because there's nothing like this book. I mean, Game Over kind of comes close, but it doesn't really dive as deep as Console Wars does.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, honestly, I think, you know, a natural question people ask is why did I write the book? Especially because I am not, or at least I wasn't much of a gamer. But it was because I wanted to read a book like this, and to your point, there is so few, there are so few video game books out there in general, and then there are so few that really take a character-based approach. You know, Game Over by David Sheff was kind of the only one that felt like it was really focused on business and characters in this way. And I also love Stephen Kent's Ultimate History of Video Games. But, you know, I also wanted to make it like a story because I wanted to make this exciting industry video game accessible to all sorts of people. So I'm glad that you that it worked for you.
Yeah, and it just brought back a bunch of memories of, like, those old school playground arguments that you know, kids don't have today, which kind of leads me to my first question. As a soldier in the Sega Nintendo War, does it boggle your mind at all that there are children today that have never known Sega as anything other than a third-party developer?
That's a great first question, especially for your first interview. I'm impressed at it. But let's see. As a, I guess, okay, so I'm 33, and so I'm getting to that point in my life where kids, I guess I would call them, people 10 years, 15 years younger, do things that boggle my mind all the time, that things have changed so quickly in such a short amount of time. But kind of to answer your question, it doesn't boggle my mind that people aren't familiar with Sega, because even our generation, or I don't know how old you are. How old are you, by the way? Okay. So, you know, I think even for our generation, like, Atari was kind of a shell of itself when we were familiar with it. So,
yeah,
to, you know, people 10 years older than us, Atari means something different. So that's not surprising. You know, it's always a little sad, but those things happen. What is surprising to me is that those kids that you know, basically anyone 20 or younger, like my cousin, I have a 10-year-old cousin, and he saw an early version of the book proposal that I had, which had Mario and Sonic on the cover. And he's like, oh, Mario and Sonic. And I was like, oh, you know them, that's great. He's like, yeah, they're best friends. And I was like, dude, no, they're not. They hate each other. But, you know, he knows them from Mario and Sonic at the Olympics or from Smash Brothers. Yes. Like, so that's kind of what boggles my mind, just that the two companies whose mascots defined, you know, this great console war now are buddies with each other. So that's really always a little bit of a jolt for me.
Yeah, I feel the same way. And I feel like the introduction of Sonic into a Nintendo game was a very watered-down version. I mean, had he come in Smash, it would have been a little bit easier to swallow because he could make them fight. But it was not a Sonic at the Olympics.
Yeah, that's a great point.
Thank you. What are the three most important things Sega got right after the appointment of Tom Kalinske as president?
So when Tom came in, the ship started to turn around, and it's really hard to pin down just three things, mostly because it was always a team effort, and Tom will be the first person to say that. So, you know, it's hard to pick out a few things, but one, I think, is the head-to-head advertising and the way that Sega represented itself as a brand, you know, even more so than the Sega Does What Nintendo campaign, which preceded Tom. You know, Sega didn't just go head-to-head. You know, there was a joke in the book that said, you know, what does Sega do to Nintendo? Like, you know, lose money? Who was Sega? They were kind of co-opting their identity from Michael Jackson and Joe Montana, but they didn't really have their own identity, and Sonic played a key role in that. So I think that, you know, number one is just the type of advertising they did, and that kind of feeds into the second thing, which was just the brand identity of Sega and Sonic's role in that. You know, I think that we can't lose sight of the fact that none of this would have happened, or none of this would be, or with Sonic would have happened if the game itself wasn't awesome, or at least so different than what was out there. But the way that Tom and Al and Madeline and everyone, you know, kind of raised Sonic and brought Sonic into the world, I think that's a huge part of why 25 years later, my cousin knows Sonic. You know, there's been a lot of popular mascot-type characters over the years, whether it's Pac-Man or Crash Bandicoot, and they don't have the same lifespan as Sonic. And I think that has a lot to do with how much love and care, as well as strategy, went into Sonic. And, you know, Tom had done similar types of things with He-Man Masters of the Universe and with Barbie and with those True Will Vitamins. So, you know, he really had this magic touch. And then I think the third thing that started once Tom was there that is like a little bit underrated because we tend to think of all the games being made in Japan during that time was the development that was done in America and the types of games that Sega started to do. You know, for me, as a kid, sports games were the only thing I cared about, and Sega was the company that did good sports games. And so, you know, a lot of those games were made by EA, but they played better on the Genesis than they did on the Super Nintendo. Or Sega did do some first-party games, and obviously the Joe Montana football being an example. But you know, they made sports games, they made sports of focus, they borrowed that attitude, and then they also... you know, did a lot of like Hollywood properties, they did like Jurassic Park and other things. And they just really, you know, they did different kinds of games than Nintendo did, which was kind of epitomized by the Mortal Kombat situation. But, you know, and even if answering these three reasons, I feel like they're all so interrelated. You know, the blood in Mortal Kombat has to do with the types of games Sega would do, but it also has to do with their identity, that this is who they were who Nintendo wasn't. But that's probably how I would, you know, those are the three things that really jump out to me.
Awesome. So you chose this very unique writing structure for the book. I don't want to say this, but it's kind of like fill in the blanks when it comes to dialogue. Any particular reason you went that route?
Yeah. And, you know, I think it's definitely the biggest criticism from some people about the book, but it's something that I would do again, and I don't regret. It has to do with a lot of reasons. One is my objective for the book was to write a book that was accessible to gamers and non-gamers equally. And so I thought the best way to do that was to tell a story and make sure you felt like you were in the room and sometimes even in the head of these people as opposed to just telling what happened. And then the second, even more important reason is I don't really believe that what happened as told by people is always reliable. I think it's usually a synthesis of different memories. And I kind of feel like, you know, to tell a story in hindsight, aside from the contradictory factors, it really robs you of the energy and kind of the spirit of what these companies were all about. So, you know, I guess, history is nothing without context. Like, you could say, 32X was a huge flop, which would probably be accurate, but you could also say that it was 32X was the best-selling, you know, 32-bit adapter ever made. I mean,
that's true.
But of course, that's misleading. So to me, the dialogue was the context. My only regret with the dialogue stuff is I wish that I had mentioned that the authors know at the beginning that most, if not all, the dialogue was approved by the subjects themselves, because I think that it's kind of a presumptuous activity to write dialogue for other people. Okay. And you know, so I didn't want people to think that I was just like, you know, lying in my bed being like, ooh, wouldn't it be cool if this guy said this? You know, it was always based on the types of conversation they told me they had, and then it was, a back and forth with them to make sure that it sounded like them. And that's also kind of one reason I'm happy to be doing the documentary, so that people will see that, wow, that's really what they sound like, and that was what made it so fun for me, was that capturing these people's voices and their dynamic personalities.
See, I find it hard to believe that that's a criticism. I believe that that's the book's strength, because it takes a piece of nonfiction and turns it into like a real story. I mean, I've never seen a book approached from this method. So it actually kept me more engaged, because it's like, oh, what is Tom gonna say? Because there are times in there where I think, or I just want Tom to say, you know, fuck you. Especially when he's talking to the president of EA. I just really want Tom to say, fuck you.
Right. No, so and I that's find so that important to be engaging. Because, when Tom's telling the story to me, I think it wouldn't surprise anybody to know that a lot of the people that I interviewed, especially those from Sega, were really good storytellers. And when they tell the story, there's dialogue in it. And those are some of the moments that, when he's telling the story, I wanted to say, fuck you also. And so when he said it, or when he said some variation of it, or, when he paraphrases the response, I think that's so central to being in there. And, I think it is a little bit of an unusual style for nonfiction, but some of my favorite nonfiction books, one of my biggest inspirations, I guess I would call it, is Ben Mezrich. He wrote The Accidental Billionaires, which was turned into The Social Network, and he wrote, he wrote Sex on the Moon. He's written so many great, true nonfiction stories, like Bringing Down the House as well, and he does a great job with that. And so I felt like, obviously all of the action in the moment was meant to capture the emotion and the spirit and to make it more dramatic, though grounded in what actually happened. And then really it was all just a way to get the information to the reader. So, in terms of style, not that this is a good comparison given that what you're saying is, it's a nonfiction book. So I really... Structurally, the way that I looked at it was like Game of Thrones, because to me, I realized along the way that that's kind of what the story is. Three different houses with Sony, who all think that they're the rightful heir, who all think that they're the ones that are doing things right, and that, they all have such different interpretations of their competitors and of what they're doing, and there's so much history steeped around these moments that it was almost like each chapter was a scene in a book or in a movie, but like very much like Game of Thrones, where every chapter is a series of scenes or a scene, and then all this history, this tapestry of history that helps you understand what's happening and why it's important, is just weaved throughout. So I'm glad that you liked it, and I think it's the minority of people that have disliked it, but the ones that have disliked it have disliked it a lot. So maybe just stick to that space.
Well, thank you for that answer, because that was awesome. I have my next question is, Nintendo's approach to the world was to take the high road, whereas Sega's was really 90s, in-your-face aggressive marketing. Why did Nintendo sit back and allow them to get the leg up when they had the funds and the ability to go toe-to-toe?
Well, I think that you kind of answered the question partially in the question. In their minds, it was them taking the high road and kind of getting back to that idea of different perspectives from different players in the game. Like, I think that Sega's perspective would not be that Nintendo was taking the high road. It was that Nintendo was blindsided, or that they were too unsure how to respond, or, they didn't really know what to do. I think that, in their mind, at first it was a matter of, by not acknowledging Sega, then the problem didn't really exist. There's a little bit of the ostrich burying its head in the sand. And then I think that part of it, too, is Sega was ready for a fight, and Nintendo just didn't want to fight in that regard. So maybe, there was a few times when Nintendo did fight back a little bit in the war of words. But whatever Nintendo did, Sega would come back even harder, and Nintendo wasn't really looking to escalate in that way. But that said, that did start to change around the time that Howard Lincoln took over at Nintendo, and one of my favorite parts of the book, or one of my favorite parts about the real story is that poem that Howard Lincoln did, Roses Are Red poem. It was so un-Nintendo at the time, and it was something that his PR people told him not to do, but he thought it was important, and I love that about Howard, that he had that, that was such an emotionally driven decision by him, but he's such a logical, intellectual guy, and that was a part of it as well. But, to kind of take the gloves off a little bit there, I thought that was symptomatic of how far things had come and what would make Howard, one of the things that made Howard a pretty great leader.
Yeah. This question was brought to me by my brother. He kind of wants to know this. We all know the Nintendo scorning of Sony at CES, and war makes strange bedfellows, yet for some reason, Sega and Sony just couldn't get on the same page. Why do you think that was?
Yeah, I mean, I had heard a little bit about the June CES thing where Nintendo basically screwed over Sony and did so in public. But I never heard about Sega and Sony having a close relationship. And, you know, when I first heard about this idea that Sega and Sony nearly partnered up to do what would have, you know, essentially been the Sega PlayStation or, you know, the next generation system with Sony, I was shocked. But as I started, you know, as the book is progressing and, you know, the research that I'm learning, it kind of makes a lot of sense because, you know, even at, like, the Sega CD launch event, it's a joint event held by Sony and Sega. It was a really close relationship. So those are all, I guess, all reasons why it should have happened. But why didn't it happen? You know, I think a lot of that goes back to the issues between Sega of America and Sega of Japan, which is ultimately what plagued Sega in a lot of ways and became the more fascinating battle in this book. And I think also, you know, I think that's probably in the short term what really hurt that situation. But I think that since these all are Japanese companies, you know, it wouldn't be blasphemy to say that Nintendo and Sony always had a higher status in Japan than Sega. Sega was never revered in the same way. It was also founded by an American, which I have to imagine, you know, maybe in a different class. And so I think that probably in the end, well, of course, in the end, Sony was happy that they didn't partner with Sega, but I think that they probably still had a lot of reservations about partnering with this company that didn't have the same kind of lineage and legacy as companies like Nintendo that had been around since the late 1800s or other big Japanese companies.
Understood. Thank you. So you touched on a little bit. It's so very prominent in the book. It seems like Sega's fighting itself and Nintendo at the same time. Like, why? Why can't SOJ and SOA just see eye to eye?
Yeah, I mean, how many times did I ask my laptop that while I was writing this book? Like, come on, guys, what are you doing? It's amazing to me. For so many reasons, as a kid or as a fan of video games, it's amazing to me that you know, that's the reason that Sega, or that's a big part of the reason why Sega, you know, really eventually left the hardware business and why they're shelved themselves now. And then just as somebody, like, following along and looking at the business story, it's so unfortunate. But, you know, I went into this book imagining that the most interesting battle would be between Sega and Nintendo, but I think in the end it turned out to be Sega of America and Sega of Japan. And it's more than just a cultural disconnect because, you know, even to that point, the Nintendo of America and NCL, Nintendo Corporate Limited Japan, that's a American-Japanese relationship that obviously worked better in the long run. But it's really frustrating. And I actually was hired by Sega of America to shoot some videos by Sega, to shoot some videos in Sega of Japan back in 2012 with my business and directing partner, Jonah Tulis. And you know, it was 20 years later, so no direct comparisons can be made. It's different personnel, but I felt a lot of what the Sega of America employees described to me in terms of the passive aggressiveness, in terms of the way that the two different divisions were treating each other. And like you, I was hired to shoot videos that were highlighting and celebrating these games. And like you, I was just thinking, like, guys, what's happening here? This is good for everyone. You know, why is this not such a difficult thing? Why is there such a lack of unity?
Yeah, it's just such a hindrance. I don't have much hair to pull out. And I was trying to pull it out.
Yeah, I mean, imagine, I've tried for 3 years, but I just to imagine what Tom Kalinske especially was going through. And then you're in that awkward position where, you know, he's receiving orders from Japan that are different than the kinds of orders he was receiving at the beginning, and all that's happened in between is that he's been more successful, and then he has to relay that to his employees, who aren't happy with that, and it looks like it's his decision, or he has to be the guy to, you know, be a good team player. It's just such a frustrating, difficult position.
Absolutely. I want to go back to the artistic direction of the book. Near the end of the book, it seems like Tom's career with Sega is a failed marriage, and Tom's mentality is like, I still love her. I want to make this work for the kids, but I just can't do this anymore. How much of that is Tom's personal account versus your artistic direction?
Well, I would say that I can't think of a place in the book where my artistic direction wasn't driven by the actual events. And I don't even just mean in terms of like who, what, where, when, how, but in terms of the personality and that feeling that it was meant to evoke, that sentiment to me was personified by a conversation I had with Ellen Van Buskirk, who, you know, she's EBDB in the book, and she had left Sega a couple years before Tom, and she had met with Tom, I think in 95, maybe it was late 94, and she was basically telling her, you know, he confided how difficult things were, and she said, you know, why don't you leave now? And he said that, you know, he was the captain of the ship for the good times, and he's going to be the captain of the ship for the bad times. So, you know, that's something that was, that like, that's just the kind of guy that he is. He didn't say that to the press. That wasn't like him posturing. That was just him having a private conversation with a trusted confidant. And, you know, I wanted to make sure that impression was given to readers, because that's the kind of guy he is, and I think he's a really remarkable, special leader.
Yeah, it seems throughout the whole book, he carries himself with class. Even in the face of, like, disrespect and eternal loss, he just finds a way to keep pushing forward, and he always does it with his head high and with class. And that's how it's very well portrayed, so I'm certain that's what you took from your conversations with him.
Yeah, no, but at the same time, I could see people in Sega Japan thinking that Tom's arrogant. I don't think he is, or maybe I just don't think that kind of arrogance is the bad thing. I would say that it's really boldness, like, you know, his 4-point plan, those kinds of things. You know, he doesn't mince his words. And from Nintendo's perspective, one of my favorite lines is when I interviewed George Harrison, and he referred to Tom as the music man, like marching into town, getting everyone excited, but there was really nothing behind him. It was all just like smoke and mirrors. So, you know, I think it's important that the book show that there's this different point of views. I tend to think that Tom's an incredible leader. But as part of what I wanted to come from the book is that history is a matter of perspective. So, even though Tom has obviously been a hero of this story, there are some people see those heroic strengths as flaws.
Yeah. Thank you. Since you said it, you brought up, you segued me perfectly. Console Wars seems to have been designed with the idea of the preservation of video game history. With video games becoming more and more geared to digital and online form of media, can you give an opinion on what, if anything, needs to be done to ensure the preservation of video games and its history?
I definitely can't tell you what would ensure it. I think that luckily, there's a lot more attention paid to video game history now than there was even 5 years ago. It's really just a matter of people caring and wanting to preserve that history. And my contribution to that was this book, and hopefully it's an inspiration to others to want to try to preserve that history. But it's hard because, I'm working on a book now about virtual reality, and I only mention that because it's a story that's obviously still happening, but it's happening in an age where there's email and text messages and recorded conversations, and it's almost automatically preserved. Whereas back in the early 90s and the 80s of gaming and the 70s, you know, the documents are so often destroyed, it's really hard, you know, to come across those things. And so, I think that it takes people who are just inspired by it, because for the most part, there's no monetary benefit to it. It's often a thankless job. But I do think a lot of people believe it to be important, and I'm happy that there's, you know, so much. Maybe it's just the circles I run in online, but I feel like more and more stuff is being unearthed and being celebrated.
No, I agree. There's a new book series coming out that I'm looking forward to getting into. It's Legends of Localization. That book is supposed to chronicle the localization of games from Japan to America, and that's a way of preserving the history. And I, especially, it's very specific because it's the way it comes from Japan to the changes we make here in America that a lot of people don't really see. And it's just a way to get us back to that point where we can remember why these games are special.
Yeah, and I think to kind of add to the conversation in terms of like what could be done, I think the number one thing to be done is to interview and get firsthand accounts from the people themselves. You know, a lot of the limited video game literature out there doesn't even come firsthand. A lot of times it comes secondhand, or someone's writing an article, it comes from looking up on Wikipedia. And, you know, some, maybe it's right, maybe it's wrong, but you'll get a more comprehensive account from these people. And, you know, as time moves forward, nobody's getting younger. So it's important to try to get that firsthand account while we still can, and just to have it for our records. And, you know, in addition to the Console Wars project, Jonah and I had also been and are still also doing a documentary about Ralph Baer, the father of video games. And, yeah, you know, it was just important to us to spend time with him and to try to hear what he remembered. And luckily, he actually saved so much stuff that he was involved in a lot of litigation. But you know, there's nothing like a first-hand account. And for me, that was critical to Console Wars. I remember the first time I spoke with Olaf Olafsson, everything I had heard about the way that he felt by being spurned by Nintendo was incorrect. He had a different perspective. And so, you know, that was all secondhand accounts of what they thought Olaf was feeling. And to hear it from him, even if it had changed my time, or even if he was, for whatever reason, not telling the truth, which I don't believe is the case, it was just interesting to realize that, you know, there's nothing like going to the source. And so hopefully more and more people will get their stories on record and will be found by people who are interested in that.
Thank you. You brought up your next project, your next book. So it's about VR, and everybody's getting behind this tech. Oculus, Microsoft, Samsung, they're all trying to see who can hit the first one, home run. Recently, Nintendo of America's president, Reggie Fils-Aimé, declared that VR wasn't fun. So kind of a two-part question. What is the impact VR tech will have on the gaming industry? And why do you think Nintendo chooses to opt out?
I can't believe Reggie said that.
I know. Base in point, you know, my base answer is Virtual Boy, but I'm hoping you have something deeper than that.
Well, I mean, he's a really great guy, and he's a really smart guy, and that's, you know, it's not a factual statement that VR is not fun. I would say that it's very fun, whether it's the games or the entertainment. I think that that's probably the number one thing it has going for it, is that it's fun. I think that the potential problems are memories of old VR, the cost, the connectivity, and the social aspect. These are all challenges that I believe will be successfully accomplished, but I don't think fun is an issue. I think that's the only reason people would spend the money, you know, $600 to buy a Oculus Rift or $800 to buy a HTC Vive or any of the other headsets. It's because it's really fun. And for me, you know, I love the fun component. I enjoy having fun as much as the next guy, or maybe more so. But, you know, what really intrigued me about virtual reality is the kind of stuff that you were asking about, like the what else part, the beyond. The social interactivity is really fascinating, especially now that Facebook owns Oculus, and Facebook has the largest social network out there, and that's their mission, is to continue having the most extensive and most, intimate or compelling social experience. And, you know, I think VR is a great way to accomplish that. The last time I was at Oculus, I tried Toy Box, which is an experience where you're wearing a headset and someone in a different room is wearing a headset, but in virtual reality, you are both in the same space, and it really feels like you're in the same room with another person. And, you know, that's a feeling I've never felt before. And that's incredible, and we can play catch with with toys and play a little bit of ping pong. And this is all just the first stage of it. So, the sky is the limit. Maybe. I think we're getting closer and closer to Ready Player One, which is a great book that I recommend.
I've read that one.
It's a good book. And one of my favorite things about it And I was talking with Palmer about it, that we both really liked, and Palmer being Palmer Lucky from Oculus, who's the founder of Oculus, one of the founders. We were talking about how among the many things that Ready Player One does really well, we like that it doesn't depict the future as necessarily a utopia or a dystopia with the technology. It's kind of like, you know, it really... It's one of the first futuristic types of books where I didn't feel like the author was condemning or supporting a certain types of decisions. Technology was almost like, it sounds almost like a documentary. Here's what could happen, and here's how it would play out, and maybe good, maybe it's bad, but it's fascinating. And I don't know. I mean, getting back to what Reggie said, I think back to my first console, which was the NES, which I probably got in 88 or 89. And like, I don't remember what exactly I thought when I first played Mario, but I remember that my response was just something like, oh my god, like, you just, my face just said it all. It was just like, you know, open jawed, shock, I can't believe that you can play games like this, that games like this exist. And that is the experience, that's the reaction I've gotten from every single person that I've demoed virtual reality for. And so I think that alone is pretty significant, but it's just, it really is jaw-dropping. And I hope that Nintendo doesn't dismiss virtual reality, because Nintendo happens to make a lot of my favorite video games, and I really hope that they'll exist in a virtual space in the near future.
Thank you. Awesome. So this is the final question. What is the status on the Console Wars feature film and documentaries? Can we get any details?
I'm happy to share them with you. Unfortunately, they're not too interesting. We're still working on post-production of the documentary. We finished with all the interviews. It's unfortunately a long process. I'm an impatient person by nature, so I always want things to move. But between I'm working on the new book and Joan and I are working on other projects, and Seth and Evan are kind of taking over the world, and you know, everyone should check out Preacher, their new show. It's hard to finish it, but that's only because we want to finish it, right? I think it's very important on a personal level to all of us involved. I know that's why Steph and Evan took an interest in it, because they grew up playing video games and their friendship was kind of founded on video games. So, we're psyched with how it's coming out, but, unfortunately I don't have a release date to reveal on air with you.
No, that's perfect. That's great. Yeah, because ever since I've heard that the movie was coming, like, which I heard before I read the book, I was like, I need to see this movie. I need to watch this documentary. Like, I need them. They have to happen. So I'm highly
interested. Good. I'm confident that it will satisfy what you're looking for. You know, when it was Jonah's idea to do the documentary. And, you know, my first thought was like, man, even if this was just 90 minutes of old Sega Nintendo commercials, I would be pretty interested in seeing that. So the fact that it's like a super compelling narrative with all these awesome dynamic characters, and then also has some of the archival footage in it. It feels like a time capsule of our childhood. And that's awesome, especially because when I was writing the book, I tried not to make it nostalgic, because I knew that we would all bring something to our own, and because you don't have, there's no screenshots of commercials in there, everything is described, so, to actually be able to show these commercials or to show people talking about these games, and, it's really special, and it's really fun.
Awesome. Well, Mr. Harris, it was a great pleasure having you as my first ever interview. You were a great guest, and this interview was as cool as I thought it would be. So thank you for taking time out of your very busy schedule to record with us today.
Well, you did a great job, and it's my pleasure. Tom Clancy was my first real serious interview, and that turned out well. So I hope that this turns out well for you. You did a great job asking questions, and thanks for having me on. It was fun.
Oh, thank you. Is there anything else that you would like to share with the audience, maybe how they can get the book, when they can look forward to the virtual reality book?
Sure. Console Wars is available wherever books are sold, on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, in stores, it's on Audible. Fred Berman, the narrator, does an awesome job. He watched some of the clips from the documentary to see how these people talk, and he does a really cool job of, you know, really channeling that. As I said, I'm working on a new virtual reality book. It'll be out in May of next year by HarperCollins. Sweet. And then in the meantime, I write a column every 2 weeks for the How Did This Get Made podcast, hosted by Paul Scheer, Jason Mantzoukas, and June Diane Raphael, where they talk about usually pretty awful, awful movies, and I usually write oral histories about how those movies got made, because nobody set out to make a bad movie. So somewhere along the way, something got messed up, and those were really fun. And also, fitting with what I said earlier, they're always, you know, first-person stories, which is what I like to tell. I like to hear it from the horse's mouth.
All right, well, thank you so much. Again, we do appreciate your time. Well, guys, that's going to be our show for today. We really hope you enjoyed this extra long, very special episode. We also want to thank Mr. Blake Harris for getting on the show with us. It was an awesome experience to interview him, and I would love to do it again in the near future, hopefully right around the time that the VR book comes out, because by then we'll know what the impact of VR is on gaming. So we would definitely like to have Mr. Harris back on. It was a great, great interview. And again, we just really want to thank him for his time. Guys, gotta hit you up with these social media links before we go today. You can always hit us up on Twitter at Nice193. You can email us at Nice193@gmail.com. Hit us up on Facebook, facebook.com/Nice1983GameCollecting. Don't forget to check out the website, Nice1983.wix.com/GameCollecting. And you can always download new episodes of the Splat Zones on iTunes. You can stream them on Stitcher. And if you like watching the video versions, go ahead and watch them on YouTube. That's going to be it for this episode, guys. And as always, stay fresh! Deuces.